on the phone. It is a pleasure to welcome to this program Dr. Michael Mann. He is a professor at Penn State University. He was the lead author on the Observed Climate Variability and Change chapter of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. This is the IPCC. The third scientific assessment report in 2001. He was the organizing committee chair for the National Academy of Science Frontiers of Science in 2003. He is the man who developed the hockey stick graph and author of The Hockey Stick and the Climate Wars, because one certainly led to another, didn't it, Michael?
It sort of escalated the wars, if you will. There has been an ongoing attempt by certain vested interests to try to discredit the science linking climate change and the emission of carbon into the atmosphere, the burning of fossil fuels and the emission of carbon into the atmosphere. There has been an effort for several decades now to try to discredit the science linking our human activity to climate change.
All right, well, let's back up just a little bit, because I am not terribly scientifically prolific, and you know, when it comes to climate change, I simply look at what the preponderance of the scientists say, and because I have some faith in science and scientists, that's essentially I take that warning at face value. But what is the hockey stick graph?
So the hockey stick graph was this graph that we produced more than a decade ago. It was an attempt to extend the temperature record back in time, because we only have widespread thermometer measurements around the globe going back about a century. And so from those data, we know that the globe has warmed about a degree and a half Fahrenheit over the past century. But what that instrumental record doesn't tell us is, how unusual is that sort of warming? Is it possible that that sort of warming happens naturally from one century to the next? And so to try to address questions like that, my co-authors and I used indirect measures of climate, what we call proxy data. These are things like tree rings and the layers of growth of coral, ice cores, various indirect measures of climate that we can turn to try to estimate how the climate changed farther back into the past. And by analyzing those sorts of data, we determined that, you know, the globe was relatively warm about 1,000 years ago. It cooled into the depths of what we call the Little Ice Age, into the 17th through 19th centuries. So if you want, you could think of that as a long handle, a downward tilting handle. And then over the past century, of course, the globe warmed. And you might think of that as the blade, the two of them together forming something that looks sort of like a hockey stick. And what the blade, you know, the end of the record indicated was that the current warmth appears to be unprecedented as far back as we were able to go, 1,000 years. And since then, many other studies have come to the same conclusion. But keep in mind, this is just one piece of evidence for the reality of human-caused climate change. There are literally dozens of independent lines of evidence, and it's because of that. It's because there are many different lines of evidence. It's because not just one or two or a handful of scientists, but scientists around the world agree that climate is changing and that we're responsible for it. That's the reason that we accept the conclusions of the scientific community. It isn't just because of one 10-year-old study by me and my co-authors.
Right. That, I mean, that is exactly the point, isn't it? Is because it is this is a body of evidence that far, I guess, is incredibly transcendent of one person.
Yep.
And one study. Now, let me just ask one question here. Now, when you take, you check tree rings, when you measure coral, when you measure ice core, you do this from disparate geographic locations. Is that right?
That's right, although I have to confess, my job's sort of easy. I make use of all the hard work that other paleoclimate scientists have done for decades to try to recover these amazing records around the world, coral records from the tropical oceans, the southern hemisphere, the northern hemisphere, ice cores from the North Pole, the South Pole, and high elevation regions, even in the tropics where ice exists, like Mount Kilimanjaro, and tree ring records from the continents. And so because there is this wealth of data that has been produced by a community-wide effort, paleoclimate scientists working to produce, you know, these very large data sets that scientists like myself have been able to draw upon that work and to try to synthesize the information contained within all those records. And so that's ultimately, you know, what we did. And, you know, it led to this figure, the hockey stick. Like I said, it's right. Not the pillar that of evidence that our detractors would like you to think. You know, it's not like the case for climate change rests on this, but it was an iconic figure. It told a simple story. You didn't need to understand the physics of how a climate model works to understand what this graph was telling you. And I think it became a potent image, especially to our critics, to those looking to discredit the science linking human activity and climate change.
And I asked that question about the disparate regions of the world that data comes from, because often we'll hear someone claiming that the ice core of Greenland or something, right. You know, shows something different, but you can't measure from just, or I should say, it's not as accurate or it's not as solid evidence when you're talking about one specific tiny area.
No, absolutely. And I'll give you an example. Right now I'm in Vienna for a scientific conference, and when you talk to the Europeans, it's actually been a relatively cool winter here. Not a record-breaking cold year, just sort of an average relatively cold winter. So, you know, if you only had records for Europe, you would have no idea that we have been breaking all-time records for warmth throughout the U.S. Over the past several months. In fact, we've set new records for high temperatures around the country, you know, in terms of the number of high temperature records that we've been breaking over the past few months. It's unprecedented for the U.S. So, you know, you wouldn't know that if you were just in Europe or if you were just in Greenland, for example. And what you have to do is synthesize information from around the globe, because a lot of the things that influence climate regionally, like the El Nino phenomenon, mm-hmm. they do things like they change the pattern of the jet stream or they change the directions of ocean currents. And those sorts of things don't necessarily change the average temperature of the globe very much, but they do redistribute heat. They do cause certain regions to warm while their regions cool. And so you really have to average over all of the different regions to really figure out what the global temperature is actually doing.
Right. I mean, that's one of the reasons why, I mean, I get so frustrated with the notion of someone saying, you know, it's snowing out. It must be, there's no global warming. Or even, frankly, you know, the march that we had in New York was right. Ridiculously warm. But I hesitate to say I can experience in an immediate fashion and know that this is a function of global warming. You need to really look at it in a much broader context.
No, exactly, and that's and you can sort of do that. I mean, with the you know with the records we've seen over the past few months. So if you point to any one day that was you know unusually warm, you know in March in Washington D.C. or New York, you know that's weather, right? It's the random rolls of the weather dice. But what climate change is doing is it's loading those dice. Okay, so we're seeing sixes appearing far right. more often than they ought to, and if you look at the entire past decade, it turns out that those sixes are coming up twice as often as they should with a fair die. We're breaking all-time warmth records at twice the rate we would expect in the absence of climate change. For the first 3 months of this year, we are breaking those records at 20 times the rate that we would expect if there had been no climate change. And the climate models that we use to try to project what you know will happen in the future say that this record-breaking warm winter, that will be business as usual. It will be a typical winter and a typical spring if we continue on this course that we're on with fossil fuel burning and warming of the globe.
All right. Now, so let's move to the other part of let's move, you know, specifically to your book. And it it details and it walks us through the relentless attacks that you have been under, because I think in many respects, because the hockey stick graph was so iconic and so easy to digest, that rather than its scientific implications, it's almost, I think, you were attacked because of its effectiveness in expressing what was going on in a way that most of us can understand. Tell me what the Serengeti strategy is, and as you describe it in your book,
right,
and how you were subjected to it.
I was, in fact, that's very much what I was thinking about as you were sort of framing the issue. You know, there has been this effort for some time. It didn't start with me. My good friend and colleague Ben Santer from the Lawrence Livermore Laboratory in California played an influential role in the second assessment report of the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, back in 1995, and he was fiercely attacked. There were op-eds that appeared in the Wall Street Journal attempting to discredit him, to challenge his integrity, to smear him, essentially. And the same thing happened with me in when the hockey stick became a prominent sort of icon in the climate change debate. Those looking to discredit the science, and many of them are allied with fossil fuel industry front groups and organizations that are using the same playbook that the tobacco industry used decades ago to try to discredit the science, linking, you know, their product with human health impacts like lung cancer. Well, what we've had more recently is groups allied with the fossil fuel industry trying to discredit the science linking their product, fossil fuels, with the health of the planet. And so we came, you know, my work, because that the hockey stick was became an icon in the climate change debate, this Serengeti strategy that I refer to is this strategy to isolate a single scientist, try to make it sound like the entire weight of evidence rests on that one scientist. So you set up this straw man that the science of climate change is this house of cards, you know, resting on a single 10-year-old hockey stick study and a single scientist like me who published the study, when in fact the reality is that very much the opposite of a house of cards. The science is like a puzzle, right? There's still things we're trying to figure out. We don't have all the answers, but it's like a puzzle that's mostly filled in, and we can see the picture. And sure, there are a few pieces that are missing, but it's not going to change the overall picture of the fact that, you know, we are changing the climate, we're warming the globe. But if you can set up this straw man, as those seeking to undermine the science have sought to do, to make it seem like it all depends on one person, then you focus all of your, you know, all of the attacks on this one person. You try to discredit them. You try to make an example of them for their colleagues, to say to their colleagues, if you come out, if you participate in, you know, in the public discourse on this issue, then we will do the same thing to you. I think it's to send a message to other scientists, to make an example of me, to warn them that if your science plays a prominent role in the case for human-caused climate change, if you participate in the public discourse, in the public sphere, talking about this issue, we're going to come after you too. And it's much the way that, you know, lions of the Serengeti will try to pick off an individual animal at the edge of a herd rather than try to take down. They know they can't take down the whole herd, but they'll go for that vulnerable animal at the edge of the herd. And they try to do the same thing. Climate change deniers try to do the same thing with scientists.
You know, it's interesting because I actually, I mean, in my experience, and this past weekend I was on a cable show sitting next to Christine Todd Whitman, and who, as you know, is the former governor of New Jersey and former chief of George Bush's EPA. And, you know, we were talking about the issue of conservatives, and there's a recent study that came out maybe a month or two ago showing that not only do conservatives have less faith in science and have had decreasing faith in science over the past 25 years or so, but the most educated conservatives have actually had the greatest increase in skepticism of science in general.
Right.
And I think that there's been a concerted effort to attack science, both for the subsidiary benefits if you're an industry, whether it's tobacco, whether it's whether you're a pharmaceutical company, or whether you're putting out pesticides, or whether you're involved in carbon, putting carbon into the atmosphere, but also it undermines the notion that we as a society can collectively work towards a solution for any of these problems.
Yeah, no, it's a great point. And, you know, it's interesting you mentioned Christine Todd Whitman, because, of course, she had a very forward-looking view about the challenge of climate change and carbon emissions when she was EPA administrator for George W. Bush in his first term. And she was forced out. Mm-hmm. She was forced out of the EPA by others within the administration who didn't want to hear about the challenge that we face, the need to deal with our carbon emissions, who in many cases were essentially acting as advocates for the fossil fuel industry rather than advocates for the good of the people that they're representing. And it's, you know, there are a number of, very forward-looking, pro-science, pro-environment Republicans, out there. And one of the things that I think your readers would find interesting about my book, The Hockey Stick and the Climate Wars, is that you might be surprised to learn that the greatest hero in our story who came out to defend us against the attacks by the forces of climate change denial, the greatest hero in our story was a Republican. It was Sherwood Bollert. He was the chair of the House Science Committee. He was a pro-environment, pro-science, northeastern moderate Republican from New York. And when Joe Barton of Texas came out and tried to enforce a subpoena demanding all of my email correspondences with dozens of other scientists around the world, it was Sherwood Bollert who really came out and challenged his own fellow Republican, denounced what was what he saw clearly to be an attempt to intimidate scientists whose findings were inconvenient to the special interests that fund his campaigns. And people like John McCain also came out to defend us against these attacks. And you have Bob Inglis, South Carolina, Arnold Schwarzenegger, and I could go on. You know, there are a number of Republicans who have taken a pro-science, rational approach to this problem. We can have a good faith debate about what to do about the problem of climate change. We can no longer have a good faith debate about the reality of the problem. And I think it's unfortunate that we do seem to be stuck in the latter right now.